Hello, everyone, and welcome to the live talkback session. Welcome to SPF 12. Oh, my goodness, SPF 12. This is week one here at the Road Theater Company for the Summer Playwrights Festival. We have been doing this for over a decade now. It's the largest festival of its kind. And this is week one of 3 weeks, 25 plus plays in 3 weeks. Oh my goodness. My name is Avery Clyde. I'm going to be your moderator today for today's talk back. Very excited, longtime member, first time moderator. And today we are watching Stuck with Fred. Woohoo! Little applause just from me. Oh my goodness. Excited to be here myself. And let's just go down the road here, gallery, so I can see everybody. Do we have Timothy on? Yes, we do. Awesome. Today, Stuck with Fred by Timothy Nolan, directed by Taylor Nichols. And then we have Ivy Kahn. Hello, Ivy. Ivy Kahn as Hilly, Allan Wasserman as Fred, Tom Knickerbocker as Martin, Elizabeth Sampson as stage directions, and I think we go to Timothy first. Timothy, start us off. Where did this play come from, and why did you have to write it?
It started off while I was still in the MFA program at the Actor Studio Drama School. And our teacher, one Christmas break, gave us a bunch of stories and said, come back with an adaptation. And none of the other playwrights in the program really did anything with theirs. But mine was the genesis of this play, and it's sort of grown from there in its own crazy direction.
So this was out of a prompt, or like was from somebody
No, it was pretty much a prompt. I would say that I couldn't quite figure out why I felt so connected to these people until I was nearly done with it. And then I just realized that, like, in a lot of ways, they felt very close to, I could really identify with them. Not in any factual way. I mean, I've never been in a program or anything like that, but, just in terms of, telling the story of people who are kind of all thumbs at life.
And tell us the history of the play. When you started, it was just a germ of an idea off of a prompt. Mm-hmm. And then where are we at with the play now?
Well, this is the first time on its feet in its entirety. We did work on it in school. We've done work on it in the playwright director's workshop at the Actor Studio. But when I got the opportunity to work with the Road people, it was, like I said, this was the first time we've actually had the chance to really air it out, from beginning to end. So it's been quite a ride. It's been quite a process. It's super cool. So.
Well, then I'm going to go off of your lead there, and let's go around the room here and just tell me about your experience with the play, where you started and where you find yourself now. Allan, let's start with you.
Well, I got a lot of help from Taylor Nichols because managed to help me for making the transitions in and out of delirium, and he had me make them as smoothly and as uneventful as possible, that I should slip into them very quietly and without any big adjustment, because the actor me was like, I got to do something here. And I did nothing except just pass through the corridor into the next reality. And he was a great help with helping me do that. So I really liked what I saw with his help. It's one thing to act it. The other thing is to watch it. today when I was yelling at her how she was worthless, I got very upset. My wife's saying, "What's the matter? You feel guilty?" I go, "Yes, terrible." And but I know that kind of. It just brought up a lot for me watching it and watching both Tom and Ivy. I got very upset a lot. I was surprised that I got upset because, you know, when I'm playing him, I'm focused on that. And so I had friends sitting here who are not theater people who said, you know, I don't go to a lot of plays, but this doesn't sound like a play. This sounds like life. And I thought, oh, well, that Nolan should know that. I mean, these are non-theater people just saying, oh, you know, because they were so happy because – I, you know, twisted their arm to come watch a play. They don't want to watch a fucking play. You know, they don't want to go to a play. And then they had the time of their life. So that's it. I don't want to take up much more time, except that it's been an absolute dream. I've known Ivy and Tom for years and got to work with Ivy a bit and Tom a bit, but this is the most enjoyable. You know, I always get to play Ivy's father. So once I got to play her almost love interest, which was really exciting. And it's just been a joy, and thank you, Tim, for bringing the play to us, and my colleagues. What a dream to work off. You know, sometimes you don't have to do much; you just live off what your partner's bringing you. You're there, and I was blessed with Ivy and Tim that way. So that's enough.
I definitely think that that is something that you could feel in the playing of it, that the three of you know each other very well, and Taylor as well. Taylor, who he just mentioned, is the director of the play. Our director is also a pretty accomplished actor and is shooting in Greece right now and is in the middle of 4 hours of sleep before he hops on a flight. So we are going to say props to him, break a leg, but that's why he's not with us this afternoon. Ivy, though, let's go to you. So you're not playing his daughter. How's that?
No. The whole reason I've stayed in this company for so long is to have a shot at playing Alan's love interest. So thank God that finally happened. let me ask you, Avery, can you repeat the question? I didn't quite.
The question is just how did you find this project when you first came to it? And then where are you at with it now? Like, what's the
dress? Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, I really loved the play. And I think I discussed in our rehearsals that one of the things I loved about it is it's so rare to find a play that explores a different kind of relationship. I mean, we've seen lovers, we've seen friends, siblings, but this was a very unique type of friendship that sort of bordered on, you know, love, father, daughter, a bit of like romantic feeling. There was dependency. So it sort of spanned most of the friendships I have in my life. And so I was able to sort of pull things from different relationships I already have. And so I really liked that. And I liked that Martin comes in and kind of throws a wrench in everything.
Were you writing the same thing the whole time?
Say it again?
Were you writing the same thing every time?
Me?
In the play.
Oh, see, okay.
The same thing every time she's writing. Is it always the book?
I think so. I think Timothy could tell you a little bit more about this. This was one of the things that I had, like the sort of timeline of it, of going back and forth from, I think, this sort of, this grave setting where I'm talking to him beyond his death and when I'm with him by his side and when I'm listening to his messages. It is one of those plays where I think it could be a tad confusing in watching it in this setup, but on stage I could envision it and it was lovely. And I too, Alan, felt very emotional through the whole thing. I was actually surprised at how affected I was. And my husband too was a little teary. So it was, you got him, Timothy, you did it.
Tom Knickerbocker.
It made my wife cry and she didn't cry at anything, so that was kind of cool.
I cried.
I was going to say, that's a little touchdown dance there. So.
I'm going to put that on my resume.
Tom Knickerbocker, what does it feel like to come in and see this woman in the play, and do you believe her? Do you know? Like, is Martin believing this relationship, or is it all?
I believe from the history of the two brothers, which I had to kind of invent, you know, some of it's in there. Some of it's not, some of it you just invent as an actor, that I just, you know, went with that. I'd like to say the Road Theater is wonderful. It's such a collaborative effort. I've been a member a long time. When Alan first came into the theater years ago, I was directing a reading and thought this guy would be great in this part. Remember Ed Simpson's Point of Order. And then when I've worked several times with Ivy as my daughter, and Avery, I've worked with you as my daughter. We did Pursued by Happiness together. And it's a very collaborative effort in the road. So you get to know people. And that was really nice to step into Timothy's play. And I was aware of the research that he did about alcoholism and about the war in Vietnam. I'm a Vietnam veteran. I was there for the entire year of 1969, and so that stuff was spot on. What Allan is saying about it being in the Asha Valley and all of that was really easy to tap into the reality of it for me. And of course the bitterness of the two brothers, especially me, because I know that Martin's Fred is losing it. So Martin is going there to just clean up the mess again. And what he finds out is that there's an emptiness in him, in Martin, that needs to be filled. And eventually in the play, we see him turn around from this kind of like, okay, I'm gonna just deal with this shit and get done with it, because this, Martin, you know, Fred's finally dying, you know, okay, I get to clean up another one of his messes. And he finds a kindred spirit in Ivy's character, you know, in Hilly. And in the end, we see that he reaches out. And that's nice. That's a very lovely thing, a piece of writing that Timothy did that allows them to connect and kind of make that connection happen in people's lives. So I've done a lot of these readings, as you know, and this was a good one. Taylor has directed me in two or three of these in the festival, and maybe this is the fourth one. So I've worked with Taylor Nichols before, and he's a wonderful director to work with, and he doesn't give you too much. He gives you just enough so you can discover the stuff yourself. So I wanted to say that about him too. And it was nice doing the couple rehearsals and let's go, let's see what happens, especially with some pros like Ivy and Allan and Taylor and Tim. Fine writing. Thanks, Avery.
Timothy, what is like the feedback been for you? What are the things that you when you come to this reading, what did you discover? What did you discover? What were your discoveries in this process? Oh, I want that one.
No, I'm wondering how many cards I should show here.
This is why people do the Playwrights Festival right there, right? Because once you get in this kind of scenario, the play comes to life and stuff goes up, right? Go ahead, sorry. Right.
Turn all the cards over, Tim. Turn them over. Let's see them.
Well, my thing is always like, you know, like, oh, that line didn't work. I loved seeing it together, and I loved seeing what Ivy and Allan and Tom brought to it. And I think they, you know, I'm a big believer in, you know, you write something and then you give it to actors. And I always tell people, give it to actors as quickly as you can, because actors will find things that writers don't. And they will also give you feedback that writers want. They'll give you a whole different level of it. And that's really important to hear. So I'm always, you know, I love seeing what, you know, you put the words on a page and they just kind of sit there until you give them to an actor. And then I want to see what they can grow out of that. And, you know, you guys just knocked me out. I mean, I this went farther than I could have imagined. So this was super cool. At a certain point, I guess the highest compliment is at a certain point, I forgot, like, you know, I forgot that this was my play and I just watched actors telling a story. So that was, or playing a story. So that was the that was the height of this. So
we have a comment in the chat, show them all, Timothy. So see, they're excited. They're, all your process, all the cards. I did have this thought though at the very beginning, maybe like the first third. At one point I thought, oh, maybe Ivy is also the nurse. Maybe this is all like taking place in his house and they're in purgatory. Did anybody ever think stuff like that? I mean, this is kind of, is it all in realistic time, do you feel like? Or
because, no. I mean, I like to write in theater time as opposed to, you know, like real time. And there's an element of, you know, our perceptions can kind of swirl a little bit, especially when we're in, you know, very emotional situations. So, you know, that's kind of what I like to bring out. You know, I think, you know, sometimes you have to ask a lot of your actors so that it doesn't get confusing. But, you know, when you find actors who get it and get what you're trying to do and where you want to go, then you don't worry. You know, then you just sit back and enjoy, you know.
Yeah, this is a playwright that enjoyed the ride there. Allan, go ahead.
For sure.
I was going to say, the accuracy of this writing was mind-blowing to me because I had to take care of my father towards the end of his life, my father-in-law at the end of his life. I have three friends I had to bury from cancer already. And I was in a 12-step program, not for an alcohol, but for another addiction. But I didn't like the meetings at my program. So I used to ask my AA friends, can I come with them to your meeting and was, you know, get permission to come? And I used to go to a stag over here in Altadena. And the stories were of the recovery in the AA program was much better than the program I was in. So I go there and it was like, I didn't have to really do that much for this play. I mean, you're so well informed, Tim, and you've been a great sponge for what's out there, that it was like putting on a suit like that was made for me. I didn't have to get any alterations. I just, it was just so easy and wonderful and painful and just glorious. So you really got a good ear and a good eye, and I know I've just got friends from my old childhood friends from the Bronx who are not theater people who are texting me in and they're loving it, you know. And I got a lot of people that I watch it who don't like theater and they're digging it. So that's our hats off to you, Tim.
Do you think Fred dies a peaceful man?
Say that again?
You think Fred dies a peaceful man?
Yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Sure. Thanks to Hilly.
All right, Hilly. What happens to Hilly after this play?
I think Hilly strikes up a relationship with Martin and then starts making out with him. And that's it. That's all that happens. I thought she was going to say. Yeah, there's a whole thing going on. Oh my God, don't make it perverse, Ivy. No, I think Martin and Hilly become confidants. And I think that she probably learns a lot more about her good friend, Fred, through him. And then he's able to appreciate the parts of Fred that he didn't know so well. I know a lot of people who have a sibling relationship that it doesn't quite gel. And I think it must be a gift to connect with someone who knew that person in a different way, either hopefully while they're still alive, but after their death, to know that this is somebody, you know, that meant a different thing to other people. I think that can do a lot for your own identity as a sibling, because you're so connected to your sibling in a way that you're not connected to anybody else. So I hope that's what happened. And I hope she finally finds a boyfriend.
Same question to you, Tom. What do you think? What happens to Martin? He's had a pretty enlightening moment here.
Yeah, and I think I agree with what Ivy said about the going on beyond that. I don't know what kind of a relationship it would be. Maybe just keeping in touch type thing or whatever. But I sense that Martin is probably a widower and probably a pretty lonely guy, and wants some connection himself, because he's got to be something he really wants besides just dealing with Fred and the end of his life. And I think that Tim has allowed that possibility to be present in the play for this character.
Okay, one roundtable question for everybody, and then the final question to Timothy, which will be what is next. But here's the one question for everybody: how do you feel this play is current for today?
I'll start. I think it's very current. Like I said, it's the human experience, and that's what we do in theater. And when we just present the human experience, I want to say something about the staging, the way the Timothy has envisioned the staging, which we are really, except with a few stage directions, not able to realize. It's a ramp, and it's not a realistic set. So things are moving on and off. People are on stage when they're really not in the scene, as you can tell by Hilly's monologues and Fred's talking, you know, to nobody in particular. So I think that would add a lot of viability to this piece, staging it.
Allan or Ivy?
I think it's a timeless, you know, story. So I think clearly it's relevant today. These types of relationships are always going to be relevant. And I also think that there is a certain amount of like mental illness that it highlights that doesn't stigmatize it. And I think that is very current and important for people to remember that this isn't something that depression, dementia, mental illness in general is something that we need to like hop on board with. This doesn't make a person bad. It doesn't make a person evil. And when I was reading the play, I was thinking, wow, this is really treating all kinds of mental illness with a lot of like, what am I saying? Gentleness and truth. So in that way, I find it very current.
Allan?
I love what Ivy just touched upon. And I agree, it is absolutely a timeless play. Addictions and PTSD keep showing up, and now more than ever, not just Afghanistan and Iraq, but also people coming out of this COVID thing. There's going to be a lot of PTSD going on for decades after this. And 12-step programs will always be busy, and people being wounded in life. And I love what Ivy touched upon. I grew up as the son of a schizophrenic, was in and out of psychiatric wards, and it was an embarrassing childhood because I had to keep it under wraps. And I've got friends now, we're all close to 70. You know, I was just on the phone with a friend of mine who's grew up down the block from me. He's an ex-cop, and his whole childhood, he hid from me that his mother was alcoholic and in psychiatric wards, and he never knew my mother was in psychiatric wards. We hung out. We only discovered that years later in life, because when we were coming up, that was an embarrassment. You kept that shit quiet. You didn't let the public know. And when they get hauled off in public down the street by the cops, it was like you wanted to kill yourself. That shame was a fucking waste of, excuse my language, that shame was a terrible waste of time. And this play is really good about being shame-free and guilt-free and dealing with your demons, and it's all okay. That's the message. That's the positive message that Tim brings, and it's why we can latch onto that so well. Like strap hangers on the subway, we just grab onto that ride. We know where we got to go intuitively.
Yeah,
just intuitively, because I'll be putting it to say, we're not improvising here. We're taking Tim's words and it's easy to make them. I'm sorry, Avery, I'll shut up now, I promise.
No, you're great. This is great. You guys are awesome. I think, Timothy, that I loved the fact that the view of a human depends on who's looking. Just depends on who's looking, right? There's so much freedom there. And enlightenment, and so certainly that is as current as it gets. That is as current as it gets, right?
I think, you know, if you think about like the happiest times in your life, it's they usually involve connecting with another person, and you know, whether it's meeting your you know, the person you marry, or, you know, I can remember like when my daughter was born. And, you know, just before, about, you know, a few years before the pandemic, you know, I gathered my courage and went back to grad school. I fell in with this amazing community. I felt extremely connected to people. And, you know, it was a joy. And the joy came from being around people. You know, and then, you know, literally within the space of 24 hours, it all got snatched away. So, you know, last March. So, you know, again, I think there's that night and day feeling of, you know, when you're in the light and when, you know, not to cast this, not to use loaded terms, but, you know, when you're in the light and when you're in the dark. And, you know, and then how do you find your way back when you find your way in the dark? Because, you know, we can, there's all sorts of things that can help, but, you know, at the end of the day, you're kind of walking that path. And it helps if you don't do it alone. So it's, you know, it's, like I said, it's, you know, you sometimes you find another person who's all thumbs at life, and you know, you get each other where you need to go. So, you know, I think that's I think a lot of people are going through that right now.
Absolutely.
as we try to reconnect.
Do we know what's next for your play?
I
like, do you want it to be produced and put in theaters?
Oh, of course I do. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Of course I do.
Yeah.
You know, I want it to be done by these guys, you know.
Is there a rewrite now or no?
There's always a rewrite. I mean, again, my wife is also a screenwriter, says, like, you know, you're going to make some changes. And I'm like, how long have you known me? You know, and you know, it's like, what, you never hung out with a writer before? Yeah, there's always going to be that. But no, I mean, I kind of, you know, it's heartening to hear Tom and Allan and Ivy say, and Taylor has expressed the same things to me. You know, if we get this on a stage, then, you know, this thing's just gonna take off and fly. And you know, that's the hope.
That's the hope for all of these plays.
Yeah, and yeah, absolutely.
I will close it out by sharing a very lovely comment from our YouTube, which is a thank you to you, Tim, for writing such sensitive and pure content. And it just, I think it just
very kind. Thank
where
you.
They live. And I just want to thank everyone who stayed here for our live talk back of Stuck With Me or Stuck With Fred. Sorry, by Nolan. What a great talk back, you guys. Thank you all so much for being here, and come back tonight. This is just week one. Tonight is Modern Minstrels by Kermit Frazier, directed by Greg Daniels. We're really excited about that. And of course, donate to the Road Theater. If you liked what you saw today, you see how this process works. This is how plays come to life. So we could use your help with that. You go to roadtheater.org/live, roadtheater.org/live, and join us again. This is just week one. Thank you, guys.